Now, the Sergey is a prime example of what we want in working with the energy sector, because he has a degree both in engineering and economics, and Dr. Goodwin, and have two philosophies on political science that was really brilliant. But he has a decent engineering and political science. He is a native of Europe, Belarusia. He has been in Colorado, another hub of energy, solar energy, but he was in economics there. And now he's at MIT. He has a lot of important jobs at MIT. MIT is really a multi-dimensional space, and multi-connected space, and all of the things I have to lead, Deputy Director of the Joint Program, Science and Policy for Global Change, lead moderator in charge of the MIT Economic Protection and Policy Analysis, and moderator of the World Economy, so he knows everything that's going to happen. And he's a senior research scientist also. So thank you very much for being here, Sergey, and we look forward to
it. Okay, thank you for a nice introduction. So can you hear me well? I don't need a mic at home. So can you hear me on the back? Good, thank you.
Maybe a mic is better because the acoustics here are funny.
Okay, so.
Can hear yourself, sometimes they cannot hear you.
Okay, so let me know if you can hear me well or you cannot hear me well. So far so good. Okay, well, thank you very much for invitation. Thank you very much, President Nihat Berger, and thank you, Mehmet Dogat Ukok. So yeah, indeed, I was passing Istanbul. I had some other business here, and because we have wonderful ties with Sabancı University, so basically we decided that it would be a good opportunity for me to give this talk. Well, I have also my goals. Well, as you know, Turkey now is more and more important in the area of natural gas. So, and whenever I am in Moscow or whenever we are in the United States, well, we have that tendency of looking big and maybe overlooking important things, which you can see much better if you are here in the area. So my hope is, whenever I said something funny or wrong, or you think, well, no, this is completely off the things which you would consider, you will interrupt me and tell me, no, Sergey, you're wrong. Just, no, this is not how it is going to go. I'm representing these two organizations at MIT. So we have the MIT Joint Program on the Science and Policy of Global Change. And that entity mostly tries to understand where the world is going in terms of changing emission patterns, changing energy patterns, changing global climate. So this is a long-term view where we're going. And I'm also a part of what is called IPCC, which is International Panel on Climate Change. So I was one of the lead authors of their recent assessment report, where we try to look at different trajectories and the implications for the global climate if we are going to continue to do business as usual versus what is going to happen when you will mitigate the emissions. Well, because if you are trying to look at the energy of the future, if you are trying to understand what is the role of renewables, solar, wind, geothermal, carbon capture and sequestration, biofuels, well, you need to understand the main competitors. Because if you are serious about doing something different, you need to understand what is the economics of the current producers. What are the resources, how the markets are going into the future, and what are the prospects for the so-called traditional fuels, natural gas, oil, coal, and so on. I always like to put some pictures at the beginning of my talk, and usually I like these pictures to have some meaning. And the topic of this presentation is economics and geopolitics of natural gas. So the picture on your, for you it's on your left, where you have this LNG tanker This is the LNG tanker of Indonesian flag, Putau Zamrud, and it's taking the LNG out of the Egyptian LNG plant. Well, that picture, so for those of you who trace the LNG markets, well, immediately that sounds funny because, well, Egypt currently is not sending LNGs at all. It's receiving LNGs. So that's one of the figures where, well, although you are building infrastructure, if you're in the energy business, you are building for a long term, also you see that the changes are happening very quickly, even in this field, even in this area. So you always have to be making sure that you are taking a good strategy when you are doing the investment decisions. Well, at the same time, yet another aspect about the Egypt is that, well, Eni claimed that they have found a big natural gas field recently. Well, how that also going to affect the natural gas markets? Well, you know that Israel, with their plans for their offshore fields, Leviathan and Tamar, so they were thinking that they will supply Egypt with that natural gas. Well, suddenly you have a question. Well, what to do with that gas if Egypt is going to have their own gas? Well, look north. Well, there is a country north of Israel which is very attractive. So again, well, I will touch upon that. Well, Turkey probably is going to enjoy the benefit of that discovery because it will be additional incentive for someone to send their gas through Turkey. Well, the picture on your right also has some meaning. Well, first of all, happy faces. You see, well, Russian president at that time, Dmitry Medvedev, now he's prime minister, and German Chancellor Angela Merkel. So you wouldn't see a picture like that anymore, obviously, between these two for, well, probably for quite a while. And so they're opening Nord Stream. Well, again, the economics and geopolitics. Well, 2 days ago, actually, in Vladivostok, it was a signing of another Nord Stream. So the extension of the pipeline, which is going to be doubling the capacity of the existing Nord Stream. So again, you have to be kind of very strategic in trying to understand, well, how the markets are evolving and how they are going to go into the future. Okay. So let's start with setting the stage. So what do we mean? Well, hopefully everybody knows what is economics. Well, you don't need to define that. When I was taking my economics courses in the United States, usually it was defined as the study how people make choices under scarcity. So you have certain resources and you need to make choices. And so that's the main thing what economics is studying. Well, geopolitics is a little bit less defined term. So what is geopolitics? It's when you have some geographic factors which affects your international politics. And when we are talking about the energy geopolitics or natural gas geopolitics, well, it means that you have certain energy supply or energy demand which influencing the decisions which you are going to make with regard to the to other countries. And why natural gas? Well, natural gas still is the primary energy, so these are the numbers from the IEA energy outlook, and you see that, well, still oil and gas is a major market, and so major energy which the world is using. Here are the couple of cartoons which are also illustrates, well, what's going on, or at least, well, the way, again, how we see it from the States. So a big thing whenever you're talking about oil, well, oil price, everybody knows, it tanked. So from more than $100, it went down to $60, and people were saying, oh, well, probably this shale oil and shale gas in the US is not going to be able to withhold these low prices. Well, the price went down even further, and still, well, this nice illustration basically shows how a lot of people perceive what is happening on the oil market currently, is that Middle East producers who are trying to keep the share of their market, trying to make sure that well, this is mostly what North Dakota, South Dakota people, it's, well, Texas also, they're trying to get the shale oil producers out of the business by lowering their price. And so far, again, everybody was expecting that the US production is going to go down, but that's not happening, at least so far. And hopefully we'll have time to discuss that as well. So what is driving all this? This is another figure from Department of Energy, which illustrates how the United States production has evolved over time and how that affected the global markets, both for oil and natural gas. So the way how this picture is organized is, well, these darker colors is oil, petroleum production, and the lighter colors is natural gas production. So 7 years ago, actually, the US was the second, and take a look at their dark color and light color, how that evolves over time. And the story is that if you are taking this much demand out of the world markets, well, it means that, well, that demand is not going to go to the United States anymore, and that definitely is going to affect the price and how that evolves over time. So the idea at the time was, you remember the OPEC meeting somewhere around this time, so which were trying to decide, well, should we reduce production, should we cut the production back or not? And the decision at that time was to keep producing. And again, the main story, it was as usual, under, with any decision, there are a lot of conspiracy theories, well, what is driving that? But the major understanding at that time was that the prices are going to go down, but those prices are going to affect the US production. And so at that time, the consensus was that the cost for the shale oil production in the US was around $70 to $80. So if the price is going to go lower than that, US is going to stop producing out of those fields. And so this demand is going to come back to the international markets. But the story showed that, well, actually, it's a lot of room for cutting costs for the US shale oil production. And they're getting more efficient. They're cutting on the payments to service companies and other, the whole bunch of other reasons why the production actually increased in 2015, not went down, even though the prices went lower. Okay. So now let's take a look at the current headlines in the natural gas market. So I already mentioned oil and natural gas prices. And even though natural gas is only partially linked to oil in some areas of the world, it still affects the natural gas markets in a big way. A lot of people are talking about the Asian LNG, and well, the expectation was that the price is going to stay there at the high levels for a long time. And at that expectation, a lot of US projects, well, at least were trying to be built, and some of them are built. A lot of Australian projects are going to be online, East Africa projects. But, well, again, that market was affected, and I'll show how the prices evolved and what are the impacts on the natural gas markets. The big story about the merger between Shell and BG, or well, Shell basically acquired BG, which, well, used to be called British Gas, so which has a lot of assets in LNG. And then China also has very big plans announced for natural gas consumption in their 5-year plan, which a lot of people were betting on the increased demand from China, and also we are going to talk how that might evolve. A big driver for LNG is Japan, and with a stoppage of all nuclear power plants after the Fukushima disaster, well, it was a lot of demand out of Japan, which drove prices even higher. But it's still a big question how nuclear is going to evolve, and if nuclear is going to gradually come back, and well, how fast it's going to come back. Well, one nuclear plant has been already restarted in Japan, and it's a question how that is going to evolve over time and how that potentially might displace some of the volumes out of the LNG markets. Looking at the closer to Turkey, well, the story is that EU is trying to get rid of the dependence on the Russian gas, so the formation of the EU Energy Union, and then cancellation of the South Stream, suddenly the orientation to Turkey, now which is called Turkish Stream. Then there is a preference from the EU for Southern Gas Corridor and building of the TANAP-TAP pipelines. Well, the recent talks on how the gas actually is going to go from the border of Turkey. So if, let's say, Turkish Stream is going to be built, while TANAP more or less settled because there is a TAP continuation, while the Nabucco West probably is not going anywhere. But now there is a resumed talk, at least about two pipelines which are going out of the border Turkey-Greece. Well, another part of the world on Russian side. Well, there is a big fanfare for this first deal, Power of Siberia. The next pipeline was, the next deal, this Altai pipeline has been in talks for almost 15 years with ups and downs. And very little noticed by many researchers, but the sanctions, the US sanctions actually affected the plans of Gazprom to expand their Sakhalin projects. The so-called Yuzhno-Kurilskaya field, which is supposed to be the major gas source for the expansion of the Sakhalin, which Shell was involved, actually went under sanctions, and so that impacted the plans for what is happening with LNG in a big way. I already mentioned some of the aspects which are related to Turkey, the Turkish Stream, and again, the view, not from Turkey, but from reading the press, well, it's still a bit uncertain what is going to happen, if it's going to materialize or not materialize. Is it going to be one line or four lines? So the story from Russians, they are saying, well, we are going to wait till November, so when the government in Turkey is going to be in place, and that is decision when it's going to be made. So a lot of things which is going to increase uncertainty for this project. At the same time, I already mentioned there was an agreement for the second part of the North Stream. TANAP-TAP, I just talked with one of the representatives of this, and they told me that indeed the construction has started in August of this year. We are going to show some of the numbers. And again, this discovery of Zohr field in the Egyptian waters are going to affect in a big time the Israeli plans for these two fields, Leviathan and Tamar. And another story which is here is about Iran, which potentially is going to bring substantial resources which could feed these pipelines or the expansion of the Southern Corridor. Okay, now let's illustrate these headlines with some of the numbers. What is shown here, it's a little bit busy graph, but the main thing which you need to take out of this graph, this is the development of the natural gas prices in different parts of the world, starting from January 2008 and up to July 2015. Well, this graph from Platts and EIA actually was constructed in April 2015, and so this is their projections for oil. So everybody is waiting, well, when oil is going to go up, when oil is going to go up, when oil is going to go up. But the oil actually since then went to about 750 in terms of MMBTU, about $40 per barrel. The main idea in terms of the natural gas markets is that, well, this is the US price, so it's at about $3 to $4 at Henry Hub. So you buy gas there. Well, the cost of gasification is about $4, so 4 plus 4 is 8. Then cost of transportation, depending where you're shipping the gas, well, $1 to $2. And you look at the price, so these magenta and green prices, those are the Asian prices. Well, and it's very nice margin. So a lot of projects which were kind of in plans after the Fukushima, and so basically this is where Fukushima, and so that's the Asian price. We see the uptake in price immediately after the Fukushima. So a lot of projects were in kind of constructed with the idea is that, well, this is a very nice margin. And even though people were expecting, including the publications from IEA, that it will go to about $14, $15 per MMBTU in Asia, well, nobody expected that current price actually is about $7.50 again in Asia, in Japan. So at that price, well, we will show the economics, it's definitely changing dramatically. This is the European price, again, bunch of different prices. So this is German price, BAFA. This is the Europe oil index price. And well, this is the current 15% reduction. So the discount which Gazprom is giving. And again, you see that the price, the gas prices in the European market, well, reduced substantially in the recent months. And obviously that is going to impact the gas price gas market in a big way. Okay, so just to justify how oil prices affecting the natural gas prices, well, it's still substantial amount of natural gas which is trade in the contracts which is linked to oil. Even in Europe, well, if you're talking about the Southern Europe or Central Europe, still substantial amount of contracts linked to oil price. Much more spot pricing on in the northern part of the Europe. But here are the main idea. So if you try to understand what's going on with LNG markets, somebody's phone. I would recommend read Jim Jensen. So Jim Jensen, he's a consultant who spent a lot of time trying to understand what's going with LNG markets, and while we constantly interact with him, his best numbers, the way he puts it, well, if you're talking about the US projections, all this hype about new LNG which is going to come online and flood the world, well, he's saying that if Brent price is lower than 75, you might be in trouble in trying to set that into Asia. And the Panama Canal is going to be expanded to new LNG tankers in 2016. So it's going to be two routes, actually, how to get the LNG to Asia out of the Gulf in the US. So you can go through Suez Canal or through Panama Canal. And the thing is that most of the Australian LNG who is going to overtake Qatar as a major exporter of natural gas with all their plants, which are going to be online pretty soon. Well, their break-even price is at about $11 to $12. And we already seen that the current price in Japan, that is the spot price, is about $7.50, $7.80. So somebody is going to lose a lot of money big time. Well, in other calculations, so roughly you have this in mind. So if it's $50 oil price, Brent price, so that corresponds roughly to $9 per MMBTU for Asia and 65 about 10. This table is from the filing of the Cheniere. So what is Cheniere? This is the only project which is very advanced, or quite advanced, in terms of the LNG production in the United States. And the good thing about the US that the companies have to file the Securities and Exchange Commission. And so the LNG market, usually it's not that easy to analyze because the information is quite scarce. And so that provides a very good test, well, how good we are in our estimates versus what companies are thinking, how justified is their business. And so according to their calculation, it's very simple. So this is the Henry Hub price. Again, this is the US price. At the time, it was $4. Well, currently, it's about $2.80, $2.90, so about $3. Well, so the idea how they are going to do their plant, it's what is called tolling LNG. So they will say, okay, at Henry Hub, I'm going to buy natural gas at $4. Well, then I have some energy penalty in order to gasify, and I have some transportation expenses in order to bring gas from where I'm buying gas to my plant. So that's 60 cents. Well, it's 15%. Then this is the cost of liquefaction. This is a very optimistic number if you are looking at the projects currently. And because, well, the Cheniere actually is import terminal. So it was already built as an import terminal to receive LNG when people were thinking that the price in the US is going to be very, very high. So what they have done, they have converted that infrastructure. And so that's why they're estimating that it's $250 for liquefaction part. Well, usually that number, if you are trying to build a new LNG, is about $4. So much higher. So Cheniere actually has a lot of advantage in comparison to other LNG projects because they are using the existing facility. And this is the estimate how much it would cost to bring it to South America. So about 50 cents, $1 to bring LNG to Europe, and about $3 to bring to Asia. And then you need to regas that. So the story is that if the price in the US is $4, well, to make profit, they need the price in Asia 11. So at the time when they filed that, the price in Asia was about 15, 16. So still pretty healthy margin to run the business. Well, again, I just mentioned the price now is about 8, 7, 750, 780, depending on the month you're counting. So again, even this, the most advanced project, need to see what is happening and how that is going to evolve over time. Well, the good thing for Cheniere, they already contracted all of their gas for other reasons. But still, that is going to impact the new projects when they see how the economics is evolving. Just to illustrate, again, this is 2013. The LNG prices, the landed prices in different geographic regions. So the US at about 3, Europe about 10, and Asia about 15. So in 2 years, this picture has changed quite dramatically. So this is the summer of 2015. So Japan less than 7, Europe less than 7. So that obviously is going to change the attractiveness of LNG and the attractiveness of new projects. And the way, well, after all, LNG is a very, very costly thing. So the usual train would, the rough estimate would cost like $5 billion. The whole facility with Getty and the port and other infrastructure which is required, usually estimated, well, the total cost is about $9 to $10 billion. So let's say you're Cyprus, which was thinking to build LNG at one point at Vasilikos, and you have the economy which roughly the size of what, $20 billion, and you are building a project which is half of your economy, well, that is going to bring some issues. Yes, question.
The question is, you mentioned $9 billion. For what capacity are you talking about?
Five million tons, one train. $5 billion for the train.
Train, so what's the capacity of the train?
Five.
5 million?
5 million tons, LNG.
5 million tons, LNG. Okay, so this is multiplied by 600 to make it normal cubic meters.
Oh, yeah, whatever is multiplication okay. is.
Do you have the tank capacity for that? Would it be possible to give the tank capacity? Because they will have LNG.
Well, this is the annual production. So we can discuss. I have the information. So that would be. So usually, what you do, you are constructing several trains, right? So Cheniere, for example, has four trains at their Sabine Pass facility, and two trains at Corpus Christi, and the size of the train is usually 4 to 5 million tons, and because that's the design. So currently, there are only two or three designs in the world. Which are patented in order to produce the LNG gasification facility. And so most of them are of that size. Well, currently, actually, there are talks of getting them much smaller because, well, the original LNG facility out of the Algeria was about 0.7 million MT per year. Again, this is the annual capacity which you are going to get out of there. But yeah, if you want, we can discuss that. So this is the report, we did it in 2014. We looked at all of the projects in the world which are currently in the pipeline. And if you're interested, you can download it from our website. This is the capacity in terms of the, again, million tons. So again, one train is five, so that is going to tell you how many trains in the world are currently, well, at least in the drawing boards by the region. And, well, in terms of the projects, more or less, again, the information you can get, because there are announcements by the companies, announcements by the countries, what is usually unknown is this number. So what we were trying to understand, what is FOB, free on board, price for these projects. So that is going to tell you how competitive that project is, again, against the current prices. And you can see that most of the Australians are estimated at about 11 to 12 per MMBTU. And again, at the current prices, it's a big, big question how that is going to evolve over time. Well, most of the US projects are actually cheaper, so the Cheniere is going to be cheaper. Again, the new projects are going to be more expensive because they have to build it from what is called the green field rather than the brown field expansion.
US ones are the commercial ones. The US ones are not the green field ones.
Well, this is, again, the average for this is mostly for green fields. Well, some of them are brownfields, so some of them are planned to convert. But, well, it means that you are converting the existing facility. So the example of Cheniere is that you already have your port, you already have your jetty where to bring the ship, you already have some infrastructure where you are getting out of the gas, you already have storage tanks. Now you need to build the liquefaction capacity. The green. Well, in terms of the liquefaction, it's 2.5 per million BTU versus 4.5. So usually it's a little bit less than doubled. So that's, again, rule of the thumb. Well, every project is different, so it really depends if you're building free port versus, well, it's a lot of nuances, but that's the usual rule of the thumb. Okay, so now what we also try to get our hold of in kind of in projecting to the future. Well, do we see any major changes in terms of the volumes? So as we have seen, well, the price is a little bit harder to handle and harder to predict. But if you look at the volumes, well, the volumes actually is not changing that dramatically in response to price, even though there is some response, but still the volumes are actually a little bit easier to project into the future and a little bit easier to get it right. So the story which we see, if you are talking about the LNG facility, again, you are building that facility which is going to be online for at least 20, 30 years, well, maybe even longer. So it means that you need to understand not only about the prices which are going to be in 2015, but 20 years from now, 30 years from now. That's how you're justifying your project. Well, that's how you're attracting finances for that project. And that's the reason why you are trying to look a little bit longer term. And in terms of the major flows, well, what we see, so the way to read this picture, the darker color is the consumption, the lighter color is production, and it is organized by the major regions in the same way how BP Outlook has produced. And so the idea is to take a look where the major disbalance is going to be. In other words, well, where are you going to export your stuff? Where do you expect the growth is going to happen? The blue colors reflect the 2012 situation. The red colors are showing what we project in 2035, how the world is going to develop in terms of the trading for natural gas. And so basically, there are no major surprises. So still, Middle East exports a lot, and Asia imports a lot. The some changes in North America, so they're becoming quite substantial exporters, so the gas is coming out of there. Well, Europe and Eurasia, well, that's a separate thing because, well, you're bumping together EU and Russia, which major exporter and major importer, so on net there are no many things are happening, but inside that aggregation a lot of things happens. Well, a bit surprising that Africa is actually becoming the biggest exporter. So if you're talking about the region, the African projects are actually very attractive in terms of the cost. And feed gas for African, Mozambique and Tanzania fields are actually very, very attractive. And a lot of people are thinking that, well, that development is going to go ahead big way. Okay. So another paper which I've published in 2014, and I was happy that it was published at the beginning of the year of 2014, because like a month later, well, the problem with Ukraine started and the problem with Crimea started. So I was happy that I was able to do that before that, otherwise I would have a lot of explanation to do what's happening here. But the idea was not to look at the current situation, but rather at the major economics. So as have been mentioned, well, we have this world model of the world economy where we track all the resources, all the costs for natural gas, oil, coal, and so on, nuclear. And we are trying to project, well, if you are going to make your decision based on the economics, well, what is going to happen, how that situation is going to evolve over time. Because you can play geopolitics game for some time, but sooner or later, well, you're going to run out of money or you're going to get into certain troubles. So if you don't have the low-cost resource, well, you cannot really flood the market with that very high-cost resource. And so this is the picture of one of the pictures from that publications where we tried to understand, well, what is the future of the gas market in the EU and what are the prospects for the Russian imports and for additional imports which are going to come from EU. And so the figures here, well, this is historic number for EU production. So you see that it's drastically going down. Well, the EU production doesn't matter, well, it matters, but what matters is EU plus Norway production, because, well, that's a major part which is technically not part of the EU, but can be considered as the EU, very close ally. So this is the EU plus Norway production. So still going down quite substantially by 2050. Well, this is what would happen, again, based on the economics. So what would happen, this is the kind of niche of the share for Russian exports to the EU. And you can see that, well, it's still a substantial amount for others, either coming from IICEC or LNG or whatever other projects you're going to have in there. A substantial amount which is coming from others, other based projects. Well, if the EU really is going to be successful in diminishing the Russian part, well, it's still a substantial amount of here, but you need to make sure that you have a certain base in order to fulfill this. Well, this trajectory is a big question, obviously. And I'll show you where the current standing of IEA is on this. And the biggest unknown is how serious EU is going to be in terms of the emission goals. So if indeed they are serious about the reduction by 40, 60, 80, so the current goal is 80% reduction in 2050 relative to 1990, well, then this is too much, this is too high. So then you really are going to go down in terms of the production, and then that picture is going to be very, very different. Again, that shows you, well, you're making your strategic decision for a long-term investment, but you have a huge uncertainty how the market is going to evolve. Okay, so closer to Turkey, closer to Istanbul. So the current, I'm glad that I'm correct with my assessment that it's a start date of August 2015. So the current numbers, at least the way how I understand them, it's going to be 6 BCM to Turkey by 2018. These are the plans. And the GE already built the compressor stations. I think they are somewhere in terms of the shipping somewhere into Turkey for this pipeline. And the plan is about to send about 10 BCM to EU by 2020. Well, where that is going to go, there is another pipeline, connecting pipeline, which is going to go through Greece and Albania, and another 10 BCM. Well, I'm not sure how familiar this phase for your, for this audience. Well, this is obviously a very familiar phase for somebody who speaks Russian. So this is Alexei Miller, the chairman of Gazprom. And obviously, he watches very closely how that project is going to evolve, because, well, he has a project of his own. And so in terms of the Turkish stream, this is the original path of the South Stream and the original capacity of 63 BCM. And so these are the four lines. So you can compare with that 10 from top to up, which is going to Europe. And well, after several issues with the EU, well, that line kind of decided that the last part is going to reorient a little bit somewhere close to Istanbul. Well, not that close, but well, in that area, which is actually going to bring gas in a major way there. Well, this, it's still a big question how that is going to develop and if that is going to materialize. All the pipes and all the documentation is ready. And again, the story from Russian press that basically Russians are waiting till the government is going to be in place in Turkey, and presumably that is going to happen in November. And so then that is going to be concluded. There is the offer from Turkey, from Minister of Energy to Russia, to bundle that with 10% discount for natural gas in terms of the getting agreed to build. And currently in the talks is one line which is going to supply Turkey. It's about 15 BCM. And it's a big question how four lines are going to be built, or if they're going to be built, because what Russians are saying, well, you don't like us, we will build it to the border of Greece, and now it's your problem, you need to take it from there. We are going to stop our shipments through Ukraine by 2019, because this is where the current contract for transit gas with Ukraine is going to expire, and after that, we will ship gas here in the Nord Stream, and you need to take it from here. Okay. So this is another view from IEA, International Energy Agency. Your famous compatriot, Fatih Birol, is leading this organization. And well, hopefully all of you know by now, are probably in Turkey, that's a very known fact. Well, I actually discovered that recently in my conversation with Fatih, why all IEA world energy outlooks are in red color with some yellow stripes in there. Well, apparently Galatasaray. So he's a fan of Galatasaray, and actually he imposed that to the world, on the world. So all the world energy outlooks of that colors because of the Galatasaray. So this is from their latest projections. Again, that solid line, the EU consumption. So you see that they're more optimistic about the EU gas demand. But again, they have several scenarios. So this is their the major scenario, but they also have the 2-degree scenario, like we have. And so in the 2-degree scenario, actually, the EU consumption is going to go down. And this is the projection for EU and Norway production. So the difference between those two lines is the room for imports. This green line is the estimate from the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies, who are also very knowledgeable in the area of natural gas. So their projection that in Turkey in 15 years, the gas demand is going to increase by 20 BCM. So if you have 20 BCM increase, so you need to bring it somewhere. Well, if indeed Turkish Stream is going to go online, if TANAP, when TANAP is going to be done, so you are able to cover that addition. So you're in a good shape in terms of the increase in the demand. Well, at the same time, only part of that is coming from Russia, currently from the Blue Stream. And part of that, so 16 BCM is the capacity of the Blue Stream, which is a direct pipeline from Russia to Turkey. And the rest of that is coming actually through Ukraine. So Ukraine, Romania, Bulgaria. And again, if you are putting together Russia and Ukraine, you always are nervous if that is going to be interrupted or not interrupted, and what is going to happen. If you are going to take a look at the, again, the main scenario for the increase in imports, so we already talked about, well, about 47 BCM out of Turkish Stream, 10 BCM from TANAP. So is it, are they going to compete in terms of the volumes? Is it going to be close competition? Well, actually, increase in imports is expected to be much bigger. So there is a place for both of the pipelines, and actually it's not enough because, well, the increase in the import requirements by 2040 is about 150 BCM, so much bigger number. Now, I've mentioned that the pipeline, both Nord Stream and, well, the Turkish Stream and the TANAP TAP are going to about here, Turkey-Greece border. So where after that? So again, the capacity, if you're going to subtract the gas which is currently planned for Turkey out of Turkish Stream, so the capacity which, if all four lines are going to be built, is about 47 BCM out of Turkish Stream. The TANAP capacity about 10. Well, currently there are talks, and again, I'm happy to be corrected, about the expansion for another 15 BCM. We already mentioned that business about Israel and Cyprus, so if indeed that gas is going to materialize, well, where is the closest way to ship it through? And again, the Turkey is going to be quite advantageous in that term. So where to go from Turkey? So as I have mentioned, well, Nabucco West probably is a history. But there are current recent announcement. Again, nothing in the kind of concrete plans. It's nowhere close to final investment decision. But at least, well, there is a submission for preferential treatment for from the EU for this pipeline, the new name, the Tesla pipeline. And so the Tesla pipeline is going to go through Greece, through Macedonia, Serbia, and then Hungary and Austria to the usual hub in Baumgarten. So that's 27 plus 10. So if you're going to get that expansion, well, that's going to get about the right capacity for Turkish Stream if that is going to be built. And well, the talks here are again portrayed as Turkish Stream friendly. So it means that those who are involved in that projects have an eye on bringing gas for the Turkish Stream. Well, another capacity, so 27 plus 20, which is 47, so-called East Ring pipeline. So currently it is sold actually to bring gas from the middle of the country, from the connection where in Ukrainian and Slovakia border, all the way down to Bulgaria. But there is new development that they are saying, well, actually we can do a reverse flow. So it's the same infrastructure and we can bring the gas the other way again from Turkey up there. So those are two more or less kind of reasonable in terms of what that is going to bring the gas out of Turkey. And there is some development, especially if that is going to get green line from the EU. That indeed is a very good news for Turkey and Turkish Stream and bringing that gas out to the Europe. Well, now let's switch to different part of the world. And well, again, all the major news lately have reported on this big signing deal between Russia and China, where they signed the power of Siberia pipeline with a capacity of 38 BCM. And in talks, there is extension, which is going to bring that gas from a different field. Well, the current power of Siberia pipeline actually is going to bring gas not from the usual fields. So most of the Russian fields which feeds Europe and where the Turkish stream gas is going to be is coming from Yamal and Uringoy and that area. So this is where the major field which is supplying Europe. The agreement about the power of Siberia actually for development of the new fields from Chaianda. So the thing is that in China, actually, it bypasses their west-east pipeline and goes directly to their industrial center, which is a big advantage because you don't have to pipe all the way for China in order to bring that gas. And again, probably you are much better in terms of geography. Well, we are Americans sometimes are very sloppy in terms of the geography, and usually I love to give this kind of explanation that the distance actually from here to Shanghai is a little bit bigger than the distance from San Francisco to Washington, D.C. So then immediately people, oh, wow, that's a big country. So this is a long distance, and well, the cost of actually bringing gas also is going to be substantial from that part. So these are the current LNG projects out of Russia. So the probably the only one which is going to happen under these current conditions of the sanction is Yamal LNG. So they already contracted all of their gas and they got all of the financing. So this pipeline also is going to happen with these current low gas prices. It is a big question because the economics is not really good for Russia to build that pipeline because, again, the contract with Chinese is oil-linked, so with the current low oil prices, they are going to sell that gas very cheap, and so that doesn't make that much sense to do it now. again, another paper where we looked at the what is going to happen in terms of the where the Russian gas might go under different regimes. So for the sake of time, I'm going to skip that, and you can download that paper and read yourself. Well, the big unknown and the big question is, what about China? Because as I have mentioned, in terms of the LNG projects, everybody is saying, oh, we will bring that LNG to Asia. So this is where we are going to make our money. And bringing LNG to Asia, you need to understand the China demand. And it's a little bit easier to understand China's supply. So you know the fields, you know the costs, you know the prices. It's a little bit harder to understand what is going to be in terms of the demand, because a lot of that is government driven. So it means that if government decide natural gas is good, because air pollution is going to be lower, because we are going to clean Beijing air, so then that is going to happen. If government decides, well, there are some issues with that, then so it's much harder to predict the government behavior in comparison to the economic behavior. But currently they have the goals. The another thing which is good about China is that, well, once it's written in their five-year plan, they usually try to stick to that number. So it means that they usually try to fulfill, okay, now we decided, maybe it doesn't make sense, but that's in books, well, we are going to do that. So in their current numbers, they're saying that 10% of their consumption is going to be from natural gas. So the current estimate, it's about 350, 370 BCM. So this is the level of consumption which Chinese are thinking is going to happen in 2020, 5 years from now. Well, the current consumption is 161. So again, China way, you're more than doubling in 5 years the consumption of natural gas. Huge number. So the current production actually 117. Well, now it's a little bit bigger, so 2013. And so a lot of people were questioning, well, how are you going to make sure that you're meeting this demand? And so a lot of arguments for that additional LNG capacity that, well, you are going to bring it to China, you're going to get it to there. Well, if you are going to actually look at the numbers in terms of the pipelines, well, that's a pretty reachable target. So again, I have mentioned that the major way how China brings its natural gas is from Turkmenistan. Currently, there are two pipelines, well, third is almost ready. The fourth is under construction. So four pipelines out of Turkmenistan, they're from Central Asia, and there is a potential for expansion and currently under construction to bring gas, additional gas from Tengiz from Kazakhstan. But again, it's a long way to pump all that gas down to here, to Shanghai and Beijing area where most of the industry is located. So this is the current pipeline capacity, about 30 BCM from Turkmenistan, 12 BCM from Myanmar. Again, very strategic decision because you're bypassing this route, which is a very heavy route. So kind of potentially you can bring gas here and then bring it by pipeline, but currently it's coming from Myanmar. And the current LNG capacity of China, it's about 50 BCM. Well, if you are going to sum up the projects which are already agreed, so the Central Asia expansion is going to be 85. The Russian 38 already signed. Well, that additional line is another 30. Myanmar is already done. The LNG capacity by 2020, which is on books, is about 88. So you're getting the import of about 240 and the domestic about 120, 130. And you're actually arriving at this number very easily without much of the addition in terms of the LNG. So the Russians actually, if those pipelines are going to be built, again, are going to affect the LNG market big way. And so if you're not going to have demand there, well, what is the reason to build all these LNG facilities in Australia or in other countries if you don't have the demand for that gas? Okay, so another thing which I'll mention very briefly is that in China, actually, they have done a reform for the pricing of natural gas. And again, it's done in Chinese way. So top down, they decided that they are going to link their prices to LPG and fuel oil. And this is the China price, you see, gradual increase. And what they have done, they kind of divided by two volumes. So those volumes which are historic, which were happening, were priced in one way, and the incremental volumes of natural gas were priced in a different way. And previously, about here, well, actually, China was losing a lot of money, about 2 billion yuan they were losing on bringing Turkmen gas to China, because we were not able to sell that gas at the prices at which they were buying from Turkmenistan. And presumably the deal with Turkmenistan was very, very good, very attractive. But still, the city gate prices in China was set in such a way, so low, that the price was not enough to cover that. Well, they are moving currently into that, and so they are getting actually close to the market price, and they're actually getting to, at about $11 per MMBTU, which is a quite substantial price to bring it to China. But again, that is linked to LPG and fuel oil. So now oil is going down, so it means that the price in China is going to go down again and again. For the details, I'll refer you to this paper. So the thing which probably I'm going to skip in my talk, because it's almost five already, is a big uncertainty is a low carbon. So how that is going to evolve? You know very well that in December this year, there is something which is called Conference of Parties, which is a UN conference in Paris, which is going to decide what the world is going to agree in terms of the emission reduction. And that is going to affect all these projections in a substantial way. And we are trying to understand how that is going to happen. And again, by the estimates, the world is not running out of oil and gas. So these are the current estimates of the historic emissions in the dark form. Again, if you convert how much carbon per ton of coal, a barrel of oil, or a ton of natural gas, it's still plenty in the ground. So the thing is that if you're really serious about the climate or bringing down the emissions, it means that you need to keep a lot of that stuff in the ground. And if that is going to happen, a lot of oil and gas companies are going to be affected in a big way. And so a lot of these companies are actually trying to understand, well, is it for real? How soon that is going to happen? When they are going to be affected? What strategic decisions they have to make to go to renewables or biofuels or nuclear or whatever the choice for them if they wouldn't be able to produce oil or natural gas? So that's my last line. So in summary, a lot of decisions are affected by economics, but a lot of decisions are affected by geopolitics. Saudi Arabia actually tried to play the game and unveiled a lot of things in the market which affected a lot of countries dramatically. Asia slowdown in their demand added to the uncertainty what is going to happen, how that is going to evolve. The EU, they are trying to reduce its dependence on natural gas while they were in talks of doing that for many years. So currently with TANAP TAP, there is some light to that. Russia potentially affecting the markets in a substantial way by dealing with China, and the expectations of substantial Iran supplies, if they're going to materialize, is yet again might tweak the markets. And the big thing, which is uncertain, what about this low carbon and how the world is going to evolve? Okay, well, thank you very much. Hopefully you get at least something useful out of this hour. So I guess we have like time for one or two questions. If not, I'll be there for a little bit, like 10 to 15 minutes, and we can discuss it there.
Hi, Itik Mert from Energisa. I would like to thank you for the presentation and the lots of information and the thoughts just shared with us. I have two questions. One is very easy, $1 billion question. What will be the oil price in 2020? That's why I'm here. And the second one is, we do know that the Israeli Leviathan and the Tamar, because of the geopolitical situation between Turkey and Israel, then there had been some studies and works and just talks, but nothing happened. And with the information you had given, it's apparent that the assumption of the LNG prices will sustain for some time. That's why all of the floating terminal in the Greek Cypriots were planning, and the LNG terminals in Egypt will not happen or will be more difficult to realize, versus the pipeline opportunity to Turkey. Can you elaborate on that kind of development, plus the Iraqi gas to Turkey, because it affects us as the big utilities in Turkey? Those are the two questions. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Well, actually, it's the other way around. So the first one is very easy. The second one is difficult. So the first one, well, I'm an economist. How much do you are you willing to pay for my prognosis? So we can discuss. Well, my guess, 2020 price, well, you can quote me. Well, 5 years from now, probably nobody is going to remember that anyway. If you're going to look at the cost structure, so a lot of people were thinking that the long-term equilibrium is at about $60, 60 to 70. And the idea was the unconventional oil in the US, well, it's a lot of thing which is almost completed, except, well, the fracking is not done. So a lot of wells actually ready and waiting. And they are not finalizing those wells because of the prices. So it means that as soon as the price is going to go down, going to go up again, they are going to supply, and that is going to bring the price. So the only question was in mind, well, what is the cost? What is real cost for these companies? And it turns out that these companies actually have done much better than a lot of people were thinking they are doing. And while we are working with a lot of these companies, we are working with service companies like, well, Halliburton and, I would name, well, it's service companies, which are actually doing the job for those companies. And they are currently screaming because previously they were getting all these margins and now they got squeezed, but they're still producing. So it means that, well, actually the improvement in efficiency is much larger than people were expecting. And currently they are saying, well, $40, no problem, we can produce. So that's the biggest uncertainty. I am a bit skeptical about that 40 numbers. So my guess, 60, 70, that's the range. Well, the difficult question. A couple years ago, actually, I was doing a project in Cyprus. We were trying to understand, is it the case for Cyprus LNG or not? And I thought that it's a very small project out of MIT, and I showed up in Cyprus, well, not knowing much, but I've learned a lot since then about Cyprus. And immediately I was in the middle of a big controversy, so the US ambassador, other people, and I was, what's going on? I'm just a researcher from MIT. What is all this hype? And Minister of Energy and, well, we had at some point talks that the president of Cyprus is going to show up. Well, he never showed up, but at least people were expecting. And, well, that project actually very heavily politicized because, well, the economic answer is very simple. Bring that gas to Turkey. Build pipeline, bring it to Turkey. Well, you know that politically it's, well, it's not going to go that easy. So the idea actually, and this is where the US Embassy, why they were involved, they were actually was hoping that, well, that somehow may unite these two parts and kind of, if you have a joint project, if there is at least some opportunity, some possibility of bringing that gas to Turkey, that actually may bring a little bit more stability because you have something to lose if you are not cooperating. So, coming back to Israelis, well, it's also not an easy answer. Again, the most economic answer is very straightforward. Bring it here. If you are looking at the recent statements by Israelis, they now much more positive about that. But still, it's a big, big question, so difficult question to answer. One more.
This is Mehmet Evirgen. I'm a student, I'm a master's student in Sabancı University at the Energy Technology Management and Energy Technologies and Management Program. My next question will be on Caspian Sea's status. We know that Europe is desperately looking for diversification of its natural supplies and so forth. Tap on tap is here, is a very big important role. starting from Baku, ending end to Italy. What about Turkmenistan and Kazakhstan? Trans-Caspian Sea project, for example, for Turkmenistan. We know that Turkmenistan is the fourth in the world in terms of natural gas reserves, Kazakhstan also. So my question is, the Caspian Sea statue, what about it? What is it going to be about it?
Well, that's another very easy question. Since you're asking, you're a little bit familiar with that, well, there is no treaty about the Caspian Sea, right? So the issue is that, well, there is no treaty between Turkmenistan and Azerbaijan. And so that's the reason why Turkmenic gas actually is not coming through the Caspian Sea. Well, it's a lot of push to get Turkmen gas this way, but, there are a lot of political will not for that not to happen from other parties. And while now Turkmenistan has a very big long-term buyer for its gas, and so China, and so they are actually kind of made a case that Turkmenistan is always selling the gas at its borders. So for example, for Russia or for somebody else, well, it's when you are crossing the border of the EU, that's where the gas changes the ownership. So Turkmenistan is saying, well, we are selling that at Turkmen borders. It's your problem how to get that gas out of there and bring it to your home country. So it means that if EU wants to build that, they need to buy it and get the risk of transporting that. But currently, the status of Caspian Sea is not decided. Well, you have another route, southern route, but then you have to have a deal between Turkmenistan and Iran. And again, Iran is another party which doesn't want to sign up that deal about the Caspian Sea. So that's also a little bit questionable. So who knows what is going to happen. Right now, I wouldn't bet that Turkmen gas in the near future is going to go west. Most likely, most of the Turkmen gas is going to go to China. So that's my bet, best bet. But who knows? Things happen. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. yeah.